Welcome to the Ministry of Changed Lives. And today we're going to be talking about a crucial topic in terms of my relationship with God. We are going to be talking about how to hear God's voice, how to learn how to hear God's voice. It's extremely important in terms of my relationship with God. But more about that a little bit later. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you that you are a God that is willing to talk to us, that is able to talk to us, that wants to talk to us. But Father, so many times we battle to hear your voice between so many conflicting voices out there. And we pray, Father, that you will use today's sermon and today's teaching as a foundation for us to build upon so that we can hear your voice better, so that we can have fellowship with you, so that we can have communication with you, so that we can get direction and comfort from you. So Father, we pray that you will bless this time together and that your Holy Spirit will breathe upon your word and that your Spirit will open our minds so that we could see and hear and taste Jesus. We pray that you will bless our time together. We pray this, we ask this, in the name above all names, the name of Jesus. Amen. Let's worship Him together.
See you.
Today we're going to be talking about how to hear God's voice, and it's an extremely important topic in terms of my relationship with God. But before we delve into the subject, I just would like to share a short story out of my life. Now, living in South Africa, one of the things that I don't do as a rule, or in fact something that I don't do at all, is that when I'm driving and there's people hitchhiking next to the road or people asking for a lift, I never ever stop and pick people up. Now, there's perhaps a few of you that are listening at this moment and you're thinking, ah, but you're a scary cat. Perhaps I'm a bit scared and a bit weary in that sense. I know there's a lot of people that do that, and you might be one of them, but I am not one of the people that pick up people. A few years ago, I was driving on the N1 close to Roodepoort, and I was on my way to a meeting on the East Rand. And while I was driving on the highway doing 125, 130, very close to Southcote, I saw an elderly, grey-haired, thin gentleman standing next to the road. But he looked very stressed, he looked very anxious, and he was standing next to a little Renault car. And as I was approaching him, and as I saw him in the distance, I felt the Spirit saying to me that I must stop and that I must pick this gentleman up. But now I've got this preconceived notion that, listen, I don't stop to pick people up. I've heard too many stories of people trying to be good Samaritans and then they get robbed or they get held up at gunpoint. So I don't do that as a rule. And now I'm driving, and as I'm driving, I'm experiencing that the Spirit is saying to me that I must stop and I must pick this gentleman up. But in the same time, I've got this battle on the inside going on. And to cut a long story short, I passed this gentleman, but this impression didn't want to go away. So I went to the next off-ramp, turned around, and I drove back. And as I was driving back, I started negotiating with God, which is not a good thing to do because He doesn't negotiate with us. And as I was driving back, I said to the Lord, listen, if this guy is still standing there, because it took another 5 or 7 minutes to get back to the same point, if this guy is still standing there, then I will know that it is You who was speaking to me. And lo and behold, as I was driving in the opposite direction, I saw the guy on the other side of the highway. So I made a long U-turn, got back to him. And when I stopped at him, I could see that this guy is totally out of it. He couldn't speak. He was so traumatized. And what happened to him, he lives in Randburg, and as he was pulling out of his driveway, he saw somebody that he thought he knew well, picked him up, and this guy held him up at gunpoint, took him to some mine deeps, roughed him up, took his car keys, took his cell phone, took his money, robbed him, hurt him in the process. And now he was standing next to the highway, and he was out of it. He was traumatized, he was attacked, and he actually stood there for 3 hours next to this highway. Apparently there was a few Metro police that had passed him, they didn't stop. Apparently there was police cars that had passed him and they didn't stop as well. And eventually he got so desperate that this old man, he cried out and he said, Jesus, please send somebody to help me. And here I am driving in my car, and Jesus, through His Spirit, was speaking to me to stop. So I stopped, I helped him into the car, took him back to Randburg, and while I was taking him back, I was praying to him, asking the Spirit to comfort him, to take away the trauma, to take away the pain. I dropped him off at the home, and now you can just imagine when I drove into the house and his family was there, and immediately they were very aggressive towards me, and why am I here and what am I doing with their father and what's going on here? And they were just ready to fight. And then they heard the story and they calmed down, and then their son said, could I please take him to their car? And he got the spare key, and so now we're back on the highway, driving back to Southgate. And as we were spending time in the car, he told me, he's an atheist. He doesn't believe in God. And I said, you know what? That's very funny, because your dad was standing next to that road for 3 hours. Eventually, he cried out to Jesus, to that God that you don't believe exists. And he cried out to Jesus, and that same Jesus whispered into my ear to stop and to help him, which I don't normally do. And he wasn't prepared for it, and he didn't want to hear it, but he got a whole sermon about God and making right with God and about the fact that God existed. So I was on my way to another boring meeting, and that boring afternoon that I was looking forward to turned out to be a wonderful adventure with God, because I heard His voice. So it's extremely important that we learn how to hear His voice. Blackaby and King says, if you have trouble hearing God's voice, you have trouble at the heart of Christianity. Now, I must be honest, for quite a long time in my life, I really battled to hear God's voice. And I'm sure you've met people, and then they say, God said this to me, and God said that to me, and you can actually see that they are accurate. And they have a track record of hearing God regularly and accurately. It wasn't the case in my life. And then somebody gave me the following piece of scripture. Concerning Him, we have much to say, and it's hard to explain, since you have become dull of hearing. I had a few carrots in my ears, and I had a few carrots in my ears, and I became dull of hearing because of sin in my life, because of living fleshly. And living fleshly, not being in tune with the Spirit, I battled to hear His voice. So just right here at the beginning, if you are living out of your flesh, and your body and fleshly and worldly desires are having the last say in your life, you are going to battle to hear God's voice. So the first thing that we need to do is we need to clear up our life, and we need to live a righteous and holy life so that we can experience God's and hear His voice. But the first thought that I would like to share with you is, firstly, God speaks through His Word. Now, it's very important that we need to spend time in His Word. We need to study His Word. We need to meditate on His Word. We need to get to know His Word. Because God will never ever tell us to do something that is directly opposed to His Word. Now, people tend to think that I'm exaggerating when I share the following example, but it's really happened to me on not one, but actually on a few occasions. I've had a few men that came to me at my office telling me, listen, they've decided to go through a divorce, and they're going through a divorce they've decided to get divorced because God has actually told them to marry their secretary. Now, I don't have to think about this. I don't have to, and it's truth, Bob. It's a true story. I'm not exaggerating. I don't have to think about this. I don't have to pray about this. I don't have to search the scriptures about this, because I immediately know what God's will is in the situation. Firstly, He said He hates divorce. The seventh commandment is very clear about this, that you are not allowed to have an adulterous relationship. So the Word is clear. Because I know the Word, I can immediately tell them that, listen, you are hearing a voice. It might be your hormones speaking. It might be demons speaking. It might be lust speaking. But it's definitely not God speaking. So if we know His Word, there's a lot of cases that we wouldn't have to think or pray about what we have to do going forward. Then secondly, it's extremely important that we learn and practice to hear Him every day. Now, what typically happens is that somebody, they're not really skilled or practiced to hear God's voice. And then all of a sudden, they get a promotion, or they get a job and opportunity overseas, and they've never really learned how to hear God's voice. But now all of a sudden, this is a big decision. It impacts my family. My whole future might be different. And I need to hear from God. I need to make sure whether this is from God. And then all of a sudden, they want to start praying, and they want to hear God's voice. And then we're running around, and we're asking this prophet, and we're asking this guy, and we run to the pastor. We need to learn how to hear God's voice for ourselves. And we start off by doing that, by each and every day opening up His Word. Before we need to make the big decisions, we need to cultivate the ability to hear Him in the small things. So I need to spend time in the Word, and I open up the Word not out of tradition, not being religious, not ticking all the boxes, not asking Gabriel to take a picture of me so that God can know that I'm a good boy and I'm actually spending time in His Word. I'm opening up the Word. Leonard Sweet says, open up the Word and let God out. So I open up the Word and I start reading it so that I can hear God's voice. And sometimes He will talk to me about a certain sin, and that sin I need to confess and I need to stop doing it. Sometimes He will give me a commandment, something that He expects me to do. Sometimes He will give me a promise, and He will say, listen, concerning your finances, concerning your health, this is the promise. I need to believe that promise. Sometimes He talks to me about my identity. Now, I don't know whether you've experienced it, but sometimes I've sat in messages or listened to sermons, and I was listening to the sermon with my headphones, or sitting in a church listening, and the guy was speaking, and sometimes my thoughts wander, and then all of a sudden he reads a piece of scripture, or there's or I spend time in the morning and I'm reading, and there's a piece of scripture, and it sort of jumps out of the page. It just strikes a chord. It speaks to my mind, my heart, my life. It's like a shot to the head, and it just strikes you. Then you can know that you know that you know that God is talking to you. And we need to cultivate this as a lifestyle. We need to get up in the mornings. We need to spend time in His Word, with the expectancy that God wants to speak to me, with the expectancy that He's going to meet with me. So we need to spend time in the Word, and we need to practice that every day. And remember, John 1 says, Jesus was the Word. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. And He spoke the Word, and galaxies came into existence. So Jesus, He is verbally inclined. He is the one that loves to speak, and He wants to speak to you every day. So we need to practice and learn and fine-tune our ears so that we can hear His voice. I think there's three very important steps that we need to take so that we can hear His voice. Firstly, believe that He can, that He wants to, that He will speak to you. I have to believe that. We are His sheep. He's the shepherd. The shepherd wants to speak to us. The shepherd wants to tell us, there's danger here. The shepherd wants to tell us, there's food and there's provision here. The shepherd wants to tell us, this is the road, this is the direction that we need to go in. So He wants to speak to us. Then, very important, when it comes to the spiritual world, we either have one or two influences. It could be demons and Satan speaking to us, or it could be God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, or His angels bringing a message to us. There's one or two sources in the spiritual world that could speak to us. And we need to bind the evil influence so that we don't hear His voice, and so that we are attuned to the voice of God. Now listen, Jesus, when He was tempted and in the wilderness, He heard Satan speaking to Him. Adam and Eve, when they were in the garden, they clearly heard the serpent, clearly heard Satan speaking to Him. So as we go through life, as a Christian and all of us on this earth, we can hear Satan's voice, we can hear our own voice, and we can hear God's voice. And therefore we need to bind the voice of the evil one so that we can hear God's voice. And then, it's extremely important to lay down your own will when you go to God and ask Him for guidance and direction concerning a decision. say, for example, you get offered two positions and you go to God and you pray and you ask God, listen, which one of the two should I take? You get a position offered from Sasol and you get a position offered from Medbank. But in your heart, you actually want to take the position at Sasol, and it's a better salary and better this and better. And you've actually made the decision, I'm going to work at Sasol. Now listen, if you go to God and you've actually already made up your mind, you've made the decision, I'm going to take the job at Sasol, and you go to God and you ask Him, God, Nedbank or Sasol, I guarantee you that you're going to hear Sasol. You are going to hear what you want to hear. So if you want to hear God's voice, lay down your own opinion, and He might say something else or different to what you want to hear. And then it's extremely important to test and see that it is God speaking to you. Now, over the years, I've had people in the congregation and people outside of the congregation. Let me just use a general example. You might be working in the corporate world, and the corporate world is fast-paced, and there's a lot of pressure, and it's long hours, and they expect a lot of you, and you might be working there for 20, 30, or 35 years, and then you just reach a stage where you decide, listen, I can't take this anymore, I can't stand it anymore, I want to start my own business. And I've actually had quite a few people that have come to me with those sort of and different scenarios. And now there's a lot of times that God guides people to start their own businesses. But I've had people that are just sick and tired of a corporate world, and they decide they're going to start their own business. They come and speak to me about it. We pray about it, and then we experience, I've had a few people that we've experienced that God says, no, this is not my will. They actually go to Bible studies or cell groups or prophets, and the prophets say the same thing to them. But they just decide, listen, I've had it. I can't take this lifestyle anymore. I'm going to start my own business. And I've had people that lose their jobs, lose their cars, lose their houses, lose their pension, lose everything because they heard what they wanted to hear. They heard God wrongly. So it's extremely important, especially in big decisions, to make sure that we are hearing God's voice correctly. Now, when God speaks to you, your flesh, or even Satan speaks to you. So God can speak to us, our flesh can speak to us, or Satan can speak to us. So it takes the form of a thought in your mind. And you will hear a voice in your mind, but it actually comes as a thought. That afternoon when I was driving on the highway and God told me, stop and help this guy, it came to me as a thought. But now I have to try and discern, is this thought, is it me, is it Satan, or is it God? So it's very important. So we need to bind sinful patterns, sinful thoughts in our minds. We use our powerful God tools for smashing warped philosophies, tearing down barriers erected against the truth of God, fitting every loose thought and emotion and impulse into the structure and life shaped by Christ. So we need to bind every stronghold in our minds and break it off so that we can hear God's voice clearly. So then surrender to God, stand up to the devil and resist him, and he will turn and run away from him. So, if we want to hear God, we need to lay down our lives. We need to live in righteousness with God. We need to be in right standing with God. And we need to make the decision, I'm going to obey Him with my body, with my thoughts, with my mind, with my emotions, with my money, with my relationships. And as I submit to God, the devil will flee from me. And then it's either myself or God speaking to me. And then it becomes easier to hearing God's voice. Colossians 3 says, live as one who has died to everything, to every form of sexual sin and impurity. Live as one who died to diseases and desires for forbidden things, including the desire for wealth, which is the essence of idol worship. When you live in these vices, you ignite the anger of God against these acts of disobedience. So as we live pure, as we live holy, it becomes easier to hear God's voice. Now, as I said, Satan can speak to us. Our own thoughts can be speaking to us, or God can be speaking to us. So when is it Satan, when is it me, and when is it God? Well, when it's Satan, can you remember when Satan started speaking to Eve? He said, he comes with doubt. Did God really say you're not supposed to be doing this? It comes in the form of a temptation. It comes in the form of fear. It comes in the form of negative, disbelieving thoughts, discouraging, hopeless thoughts. Whenever you have the urge to end your life, I can assure you the strongest urge that God has created you with is the urge to live and to survive. And when you have something that is contrary to that, you can know that it's the evil one speaking to you. When is it just me? When it's about my ego, my own honor, selfishness, comfort, reason, when I start reasoning with God, that's normally self-speaking. When it's about money, you can be sure that's normally your own desires speaking to you. And when is it God? Well, when it's positive, when it's faithful, when it's optimistic, when it's uplifting, when it's in line with the Word, then we can know this is God speaking to us. So we need to be able to discern between these three areas of influence. 2 Corinthians says, "And I will make sure that by the testimony of two or three witnesses, every matter will be confirmed." Now, when we need to make big life-altering decisions, you will get a certain scripture, you will have a certain desire, you will have certain thoughts, but we need to test this. When you read and spend time in a book like Proverbs, Proverbs says, get wise counsel. When you wage war, get many counselors. So when you make a big decision, go and test it with a few spiritually mature, wise people. Get counsel and get it tested by three or two witnesses. Beloved, do not put faith in every spirit, but prove or test the spirits to discover whether they proceed from God. The Bible is clear about this, that there's a spiritual world, and not everything that you are going to be hearing spiritually comes from God. Sometimes it's an evil spirit speaking to you. Romans 8 therefore says, "The mind governed by the flesh is death. The mind governed by the Spirit is life and peace. The mind governed by the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Those who are in the realm of the flesh cannot please God." And I would like to add, if you are living in the realm of the flesh, you are going to battle to hear God's voice. So, we need three witnesses. There are three ways to test God's Word. So, what are these three witnesses? Well, the heavenlies are filled with three witnesses. Number one, it's Jesus, the Word. So have you heard this in the sermon? It's extremely important that when you make a decision, the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of truth, and it will not lie to you, and it will attest to the truth, and the Bible is truth. So it will not tell you something that is contrary to the Bible. And when you need to make a decision, you need to ask Jesus to confirm it. He's the Word. He's the spoken Word. He's the written Word. He's the Rhema Word. He's the Logos Word. So ask Jesus to confirm it to you. And He will do it by reminding you through the Holy Spirit of certain scriptures. And it might be a scripture that you haven't read for the last 10, 15, or 20 years. And you might remember a piece of scripture out of your Sunday school days. And that might be one of the ways, by reminding you of a certain piece of scripture that God is speaking to you. John 14 says, "But when the Father sends the Spirit of holiness, the one like me who sets you free, He will teach you all things in my name, and He will inspire you to remember every word that I've told you." And sometimes the Spirit will bring to remembrance a certain piece of scripture. And that's the way Jesus, the Word, is one of the witnesses. 2 Corinthians says, "And we are setting these truths forth in words, not taught by human wisdom, but taught by the Holy Spirit, combining and interpreting spiritual truths with spiritual language to those who possess the Holy Spirit. But the natural, non-spiritual man does not accept or welcome or admit into his heart the gifts and teachings and revelations of the Spirit of God. For they are folly, meaningless, nonsense to him. And he is incapable of knowing them, of progressively recognizing, understanding, and becoming better acquainted with them, because they are spiritually discerned and estimated and appreciated. So don't try and manufacture a piece of scripture. Don't try and force a piece of scripture into something. Let the Holy Spirit bring it into remembrance and let him reveal it to you. You can pray a prayer in the lines of, Lord, I feel like the Father has spoken a certain thing for me to do. I believe he put thoughts in my mind. I want to test it to make sure it's from you. Is there anything in the written word of God that is contrary to this thought? And then let the Holy Spirit remind you of certain pieces of scripture. Then the second witness that we get is the Holy Spirit. So we need to get that witness as well. Now this sounds all airy-fairy. Now when they train pilots, they take them into the simulator. And one of the things that they do with pilots is sometimes they start sucking out the air and the cabin pressure starts to change. But while you are flying a plane, a few years ago, Payne Stewart, a very well-known golfer, he was flying in his private plane. They had a loss of cabin pressure. The pilots didn't pick it up, and they ended up crashing the plane, and he died in that crash. So what do they do with the pilots? They put them into the simulators, and then they start taking out the oxygen out of the cabin. But very slowly. And sometimes, you know, the one guy, his hamstring will start cramping, or another guy, his calf will start cramping, another guy, his hair on his arms will start to stand up. Sometimes you'll get a sensation in your neck. And it's different for each person. And so each one of us will experience the Holy Spirit differently. But we need to recognize his presence. Now, where you are sitting now, if I ask you to take your hand and to bring it as close as possible to your face without touching it, do you feel your hand? Can you feel the warmth? Sometimes I experience a warmth over my body. Sometimes I experience it like it feels like an electricity sensation over me. Sometimes I just experience a peace, and then you can know that the Holy Spirit is there. And we need the witness of Jesus, the Word, but we need the witness of the Holy Spirit. And we need to recognize His voice. I remember a few years ago, I was at a conference, and there was about 60 pastors there, and we were sitting down to have lunch. And there was a young guy there, a young, dynamic, on fire guy for the Lord. He was there. He led the worship as well. And I started talking to this guy, and I thought, yes, but I need to make this guy part of our staff. He is such a dynamic go-getter. Man, it would be great to have him. But God knew what was in my heart, and I was thinking, man, whatever you're earning at the church you are currently at, I'm going to add a zero. I want you here. And as I was on the verge of saying that to him, and I heard the Spirit speaking to me, don't do that. He is not supposed to come to your church. I don't want him there. And I got such a fright. I almost swallowed my food. I almost swallowed in the whole plate of food in front of me. And I just stopped right there, because the Holy Spirit had spoken very clearly to me. But what is one of the main things that the Spirit uses? He uses peace. And we need to be constantly living in peace, because one of the fruits of the Spirit is peace. And sometimes we are in a situation and God just takes away His peace, and we have this uneasiness, and then we can know that the Holy Spirit is speaking to us. Colossians 3 says, and let the peace of God rule in your heart. Sometimes I don't get a piece of scripture. Sometimes I don't feel a physical sensation of the Holy Spirit. Sometimes I just have a supernatural peace about the decision that I've made. And then I know the Holy Spirit is one of the witnesses for this decision. 1 Peter says, casting the whole of your care, all of your anxieties, all of your worries, all of your concerns once and for all on Him, for He cares for you affectionately and cares about you watchfully. So when we give our cares and our worries and our concerns to God, we will have a peace. And when we live in peace and when we lose that peace, we will immediately know that the Holy Spirit has spoken to us. We can pray something in the line of, Holy Spirit, I believe the Father has spoken a certain thing for me to do. I've checked it with Jesus, the Word, and it passed His test. Now I ask you to bear witness to my spirit if this direction is from the Father by flowing over me. So we have the test of the Word, Jesus. We have the test of the Holy Spirit. And then we have the test of the Father Himself. And when Father speaks, it's about provision. It's about identity. It's about protection. And we can pray something in the line of this. The third witness is God Himself, who confirms whether or not something is truth. And I can pray in these lines. Father, I've confirmed through the Word and through the Spirit, the first two witnesses, that this thought is from You. I ask for additional confirmation that this is the truth by letting Your peace remain with me. If this thought is not from You, remove Your peace and trouble my spirit to show me if I'm missing You. If it's from You, let the peace remain. So you can pray in those lines. So it's as part of my relationship with God. I have a relationship with God. So in this relationship, I talk to Him. The Bible calls it prayer. But He talks to me. And it makes Christianity a joy. It makes it an adventure. But it's also crucial for me to be able to hear His voice in the decisions that I need to make every day. So I just have one to-do thing for you today. And let's get back to the first thought that I share with you. Spend time in the Bible, in the Word, with the sole aim of hearing His voice. And if you're following a reading program and you need to read 4 chapters, read until you experience this thought that strikes you right between the eyes, and you know that God has spoken to you. And stop there and think about it. Is this talking about sin that I need to stop? Is this a commandment, something that I need to do? Is this a promise that I need to believe? Is this about my identity? Is it something comforting? Is it for somebody else? You need to cultivate the habit of spending daily time in the Word. And as you do that, listen for His voice. Open up the Word and let God out so that we can hear His voice. His Word is a lamp for my feet and a light for my path. It will keep you out of trouble, save you a lot of heartache, send you in the right directions, help you to discover your destiny. So spend time in the Word and listen for His voice. And then when you need to make the big decisions, you've practiced and you can do it. Let's pray together. Thank You, Father, that You are not like those three little monkeys that hear no evil, see no evil, speak no evil. Thank You, Father, that You are the God that hears us when we talk to us, that sees our problems, the direction of our lives. Thank You, Father, that You are the God that is able and wants to and willing and can and shall speak to us. Father, we pray that You will teach us to hear Your Word and to live that adventure with You. We pray this, we ask this, in the name of Jesus. Amen. There's going to be an opportunity to sow into God's kingdom, and the banking details will be on the screen. And thank you for each and everyone that has made a deposit and an investment into God's kingdom and into this congregation, there's an opportunity to sow now. Receive God's blessing. I declare and I pray that God will open up your ears spiritually. I declare that your ears are opening up in the spirit so that you can hear God's voice. I declare that your eyes are opening up so that you can see His messages. I declare that you are becoming sensitive to the Holy Spirit and for His presence. I declare that God is breaking down strongholds in your mind so that you can understand what He's saying to you. I declare that God is taking out the hearts of stone and giving you a heart of flesh so that you can hear His voice. Receive this blessing in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thanks for tuning in. May God richly bless you. And if this message struck a chord, press the share button.